What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Joe Bonamassa here with another exciting episode of Live from Nerdville. Today, I am broadcasting from Nashville, Tennessee, and my very special guest is one of the greatest musicians in the world, and certainly one of the greatest musicians I've ever played with. And she's coming to us from Las Vegas, Nevada. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, the cellist extraordinaire, Tina Guo. Thank you for being here.
Hi. Oh, wow. What an intro. Thank you so much. It's my absolute pleasure to be here.
Thanks. You know, we were just talking about like 5 years ago. It seems like it was 2 days ago and the world was a different place. But 5 years ago, you and I were at Carnegie Hall almost to the day of this interview. And it's amazing how time has stood still and how it's flown by. I mean, who would have thought, you know,
I know. It's insane. I remember we were all walking out the back door after the last show and it started snowing? Mm-hmm. And little did we know that was going to be the apocalyptic blizzard that left us all stranded for many days.
I think everybody was stuck for 4 days and it was like it started to snow during the second show and they were telling us it's coming, but we played it anyway. And that show ended up being most of the DVD we recorded both nights. And I just remember the look on my manager's face when he was faced with the New York City hotel bill for for the extra 4 days and like 800 different flight changes and charges. And because we had the whole crew stuck there and it was, you know, honestly, I wouldn't change a damn thing because it was fun and it was a story of a lifetime. Plus, we got to play Carnegie Hall.
Exactly. I would love that kind of problem now, especially after, you know, being retired temporarily for a bit.
Well, that's people always ask me. They're like, so what are you doing? I go, I'm semi-retired. What do you think I'm doing? I'm here in my house, you know, trying to get all the clocks to be on the same time, you know, like, and then once you do that. Like, so what, you know, I would categorize you as someone who loves to be on the road. You're constantly traveling, playing with different performers, orchestras, and, you know, it must have been a brick wall like it was for me when this thing stopped last March.
Okay, I'm going to be completely honest here. So, yes, not nearly as much as you, of course, but I was touring a lot. I think in 2019, I was on the road for about 8 months out of the year. Flying back and forth and secretly, I think I was almost like a little bit relieved, not relieved because of COVID, it's been terrible, but it was actually, I just felt a little stressed out from doing so many, because it was a lot of different projects. So it wasn't like one tour where you play the same material or, you know, a couple different sets. I mean, it was all for different things. A lot of like, you know, 1 week here and then 2 weeks there, and it's all completely different music. And I have a tendency to overbook myself, I think, because I get really passionate and really excited about basically everything, which is both good and bad. So I just want to do everything. I'm like, yes, I'm going to do it. And then I look at my calendar and I'm like, what have I done to myself? So actually when COVID,
this is a non-family show. You can say, what the fuck have I done to myself?
Yes. What the fuck have I done to myself? And I was actually getting a little stressed out, you know? And so when it all happened, this is terrible, but and things started getting canceled. I just felt a little bit of a weight lifted, not because it's canceled forever, because, you know, it's rescheduled. It'll happen eventually. I think knowing that it'll still happen in the future, I felt like, oh my God, this is like a gift from the universe to just give me a little bit of a break. You know, I do feel like, not to get too deeper, you know, I can't even talk about philosophical right now, but I just did feel like I kind of became a bit of a machine where like my entire being and my entire identity was just music, tour, perform. And I'm like, who am I, you know, outside of that. So it was actually, it's been nice. I mean, yeah, I joke that I'm, you know, retired from performing, of course, but I have been doing other recording work for soundtrack projects and whatnot, spending a lot of time at home, getting in touch with my domestic, female domestic side, you know, taking care of the dogs. So it's actually been nice. Am I allowed to say that? Does that make me a terrible person?
That's exactly the same answer I've given, because it used to be like in 2019 or 18. I'd be like, I have a great house in Laurel Canyon. I hear it's nice. I'm never there. And it's the exact same answer, because we have to be able to disassociate why we're off and being off. Why is a horrible thing? You know, it's a worldwide pandemic. Nobody ever could have expected something like this to come down the pike. Maybe Bill Gates. He was, well, I don't know. But I told people, it's like, listen, this is the year off or more, 2 years off, that I never would have taken on my own because I had to go. And you're addicted to go. And you don't know how to stop the train once it's moving. You don't know how to jump. And it's a really, really interesting paradigm shift for people like us who overbook, overwork. And now you're faced with things like going, you know, I need to get some more of those Nespresso coffee pods. And
are you like making fun of me, or did you see my post?
No, I did not. I'm not making fun of you. I actually today went into the pantry and said, you know what I got to do? This is other than interviewing the great Tina Guo, I got to figure out how to get more Nespresso pods here because I don't know how to do that. And B, I used to steal them from the hotels. That's how I used to get the coffee.
Yes, me too. Did you know there's a deal right now where if you spend, it's a lot, but if you spend $200 on espresso pods, you get 4 free coasters. They have music tips. And then, you know, so if you go to this, now it sounds like a commercial, but I just did it. So, and I posted about it. People are like, you're insane. You drink so much coffee. I'm like, yes, it's great. I have 2 machines next to each other, big one and a small one.
Nice. Nice. Yeah. Do you know, like this is a pro tip. Do you know how to program the pours where you hold the button down? And then it goes the button down. So then every time, if you want a full cup, pro tips.
Wow. Yeah. That's a good pro tip. Okay. I'll definitely experiment with that.
So one of the things I wanted to ask you is being a performer and having to wear so many different hats. Like, you know, I mean, just going down the list of artists that you've collaborated with, Hans Zimmer, Stevie Wonder, Il Divo, Michael McDonald, Foo Fighters, and... You're wearing so many hats. How do you you put them in the? There's a word, and I'm blanking on it. But how do you keep them all in their lane and service the music?
Heavy drug use. No, right. I'm kidding. I don't. You know, I am self-managed, which might be a little bit insane. But I literally do everything myself. It's very difficult for me because I feel like I'm a bit of a control freak. I just want things to be done a certain way. And I've operated like this for so long. But again, one of the many things that have happened where I've done a lot of self-reflection during this last year is realizing I really need to learn to let go just a little bit. So I'm very proud of myself that I just got a new assistant as of 2 weeks ago. And I actually let him do some post office errands, which I used to do everything myself. I mean, literally like packing the merchandise store orders, going to the post office. I mean, just too much to the point where, of course, I'm losing my mind, you know, because I'm trying to do everything. But as far as like, you know, working with a lot of different people, I think in a purely logistical manner, being a huge fan of spreadsheets, I always joke that I'm like, exactly half split down the middle, you know, as a human being. I'm like half passionate, you know, wild artist, whatever, all that, not whatever. I mean, just that side. And then the other half of me, it's like the complete 180 where I'm a robot. I really am like a Chinese robot. So I'm like, my entire life is like calendared spreadsheets. Like it just makes me feel warm and fuzzy inside, you know. I think just being organized does help, you know, with like scheduling stuff. I can't even remember your original question. I don't know how I started talking about spreadsheets.
I'm talking about in the sense that, okay, because you like me, we had these conversations. You like me, we tend to put everything in a lane, and in my mind, like if something is out of order, even in the most pedestrian way, like something is out of order in the house, but yet I have to go be creative or something else. I can't, it takes a lot for me to leave a place untidy or non-OCD and go do this because it's constantly in the mindset. Like when you're playing with, you know, Hans Zimmer, it's a very, very challenging gig, I can imagine, and stuff like that. But does your mind ever wander? Because you have the two sides of Tina Guo. You're like, I got this gig. I've done this gig. And then like me, sometimes I'm up there and I'm like, well, I don't even know what I want for lunch tomorrow. Let me think about that. And then the song, it goes by and I'm like, oh shit, you know, like that's a problem.
Like, okay, on occasion, of course, that's happened, especially if I'm like super hungry because I'm trying to look skinny on stage. So I haven't eaten, you know, all day before the show. And I'm thinking, I wonder what, you know, catering has for us after the show. But in all seriousness, most of the time, why I love and I do miss performing specifically is because that I feel like that's the only time, which is not healthy. So I'm also working on meditation now, but it's the only time when I can be completely free from my thoughts. Like if I'm really in a moment, like when we toured together, like when it got to like, you know, the crazy stuff back and forth, you don't even have like there's no mental space or energetic space to think about anything else. Right. And when you're in, I believe people call it the flow. So when I really can get into the flow and you're just purely in that moment of right this moment and everyone in the audience, like you're all, everyone's enraptured in the same like energy and you're vibrating at the same time. That is, that's when I'm free from my mind. I'm outside of my mind and I'm just in, I don't know what it is, my body, my whatever's happening. I don't even know how to explain it, you know?
You transform into someone else. Like I walk down the street and I and people go, what do you do for a living? Well, I'm a blues guitar player. I'm like, oh, isn't that great? Like, good for you, kiddo.
So
keep it up. Do you play with anybody famous? I'm like, well, you know, I don't know. I mean, well, have you put out any records? Like, I have more number one records, you know, on the Billboard Blues chart in the history of the charts. And they're like, no, you don't. Look at you. And I said, no. I mean, like when I get on stage, it's a character and it's a different person. And it's like, do you have any priest show rituals to get into that persona? Because it's a very, very different persona than just us hanging out, you know, here virtually or, you know, in person. And, when you turn the switch, look out.
Yeah.
How does that process work?
I think all of us, maybe some people more than others, but we have, no matter how advanced we get, intellectual, high tech, whatnot, but deep down inside, we are just primal animals, you know, that's, and I think for me, I live so much of my day-to-day life, normally as very, very much in my head, and just, you know, in preoccupied with like modern day living or whatever. But again, when it comes to the music and where I feel like I become a channel for emotion, that's what it is. You know, aside from all the technical stuff, like once your body is trained to become the machine that you can actually use to express something, I think for me, that's when the real music or the real art, in my opinion, can come through. And so as far as like actual rituals, I do feel like there is something very not quite evil. I mean, evil's a little extreme. I don't think evil's right. Like darkness. I mean, that this would be a very, very, we're not going to go down that Freudian whatever, but you know, all of our experiences, negative things. And I think it's, for me, it's, you know, bottled in there because you can't express it, you know, in the real world, or you might end up in jail or some other stuff. So you kind of like compartmentalize everything like I do. And then I'm like, okay, so how do I take out all of like that emotion, whatever positive and negative stuff, you know, like rage, anguish, you know, sorrow, all of that stuff that we can't really express because it'd be embarrassing to do that in real life and abnormal. And I put it there and I'm like, okay, when I perform, when I play music, that's a safe outlet for it. And then as far as physically what I do, I don't think you ever, because like we all had separate dressing rooms, but I do this weird, I think the best description for it would be like a bear growling noise. It's a kind of like a tribal, I don't know where it came from, even when I play classical music, which is really weird, but it's like usually the heavier the music is. So when I'm doing like metal or whatnot, like the more aggressive I become, you know, it's almost like I'm like separating myself from robot Tina, and then like kind of getting more and more in touch with the, I don't, you know, the wild woman, you know, inside.
It's a guttural thing. Music is in its most stripped down form. It's raw emotion if it's done correctly. And that's the one thing that people always ask me. And there's that now famous video of you and I at Carnegie Hall, and I'm doing one of my old acoustic songs, Woke Up Dreaming. And because of the bloody Flight of the Bumblebee and how I understood the syncopation required to do that. We've risen the tempo of a very fast song.
Right,
It's a great moment on the DVD, but what you don't see behind my sunglasses is sheer terror.
Oh my God! You're
I tell people, I go, you have no idea, okay, the fear that woman instills in you when she stares you down and go, that's all you got? Because that's what happened on a night-to-night basis. I'm like, whoa, you know. And one of the things, and that's to me very recognizable in the blues. It's the concept of bad intentions. And great musicians play with bad intentions. And great musicians summon those demons in, like you say, a very truncated way, in where they're not going to be arrested after the demons are out there. Right, you know, how did you get into heavy music?
Well, I grew up in a very conservative household. Both of my parents are music teachers. So my father is a cello teacher. My mother is a violin teacher. Obviously, as you can see from the way I look, I'm Chinese, I'm Asian. My parents, if you combine the music teachers, conservative and Chinese, it was a lot, right? And so I wasn't allowed to listen to any other type of music except for classical. And I think children who are raised in extremely environments, you know, where it's very controlled, it's one extreme or the other. And I think I was born with a bit of a rebellious streak, maybe. So of course I became obsessed with anything that was not demonic, but anything that was dark or strange or weird. And so the very first album that I ever heard that changed my entire existence, right, was Marilyn Manson's Antichrist Superstar, because I remember I was in seventh grade, and it was we lived in San Diego, in an area that was very suburban, very conservative. So there, even the kids at school, it wasn't really not a lot of variation in the species of children at this middle school, but there was one kid and his name was Luke, and he wore black lipstick. He had like long hair. I mean, he wasn't like attractive, but he was kind of like a nerd. So he was like a goth nerd combination. He had these really thick Coke bottle glasses, but he was just strange. Right. And he didn't really care what anybody thought. He was always hanging out by himself. And I immediately was like fascinated. I'm like, who's this person that's so strange and doesn't care what anybody else thinks? So we were hanging out, and I remember one day he's like it was some kind of like, you know, illegal thing. He's like, hey, have you ever heard of Marilyn Manson? And I said, no, who is she? You know, because Marilyn. And he said, you got to listen to this. So I had an old boombox that we bought from the next door neighbor's garage sale, because it was like kind of broken. So like this one speaker kind of didn't work. And I put it into my boombox, right, in my bedroom. I turned the volume, I remember, all the way down to one, because if my parents heard me listening to like, well, anything but classical music, they would like murder me, basically. So I like put my ear up to the speaker, and oh my gosh, I was like, what is this? Yeah, it's so, I think for me, I'm very attracted to things that are very tribal, heavy, guttural, you know, passionate. And that music is, I mean, it's not really metal. I mean, it's more industrial, but it's heavy. There's like so much just emotion in it so I started really being into that, but I didn't have a lot of exposure. So it really wasn't until I got to college and I was allowed on the internet. Well, the internet was invented when I was younger. I'm not that old, but I'm 35. My parents also didn't allow me on the internet, so I couldn't really, you know, explore. And I got, thankfully I got a scholarship to USC for classical cello performance. And that's when YouTube, you know, the first years of YouTube. And so I just started obsessively actually watching guitar videos, because there was Apocalyptica, but they're not so many people doing that type of music on the cello. So I'm like, okay, how do I make I basically wanted to be a guitar player, you know? I'm like, how do I make myself not really sound like that, but kind of capture that type of energy? And like, you know, like I remember I've had these like, you know, crazy delusions of grandeur, like, oh my God, I'm going to play this like electric thing on stage, and I'm going to be able to be like a rock guitar player. And I guess in one way it did manifest eventually, you know, but I was obsessed, you know? So that's, does that answer the question? Absolutely. It was wired to.
Well, you know, the other thing is like, you know, one of the things about when you come up with a very strict discipline, the first taste of something that is completely banned, admonished, looked down fun.
Yeah.
And dangerous.
Yes, dangerous. That's what it is.
It's like a moth to a flame. Yes. If you make something dangerous to a kid, it's like, all right, I'm in. I remember hearing System of a Down for the first time. Now, my parents didn't care what I played. They actually encouraged me to not play and get a real job if they, you know, and still offer to pay for college at 43 years old. You know, we still have a college education. And when I first heard System of a Down, I didn't know what I was listening to. I just knew it was Hyperspeed, and it sounded crazy to me. And then I started listening to it, and then I just started laughing. And it was so, it was such a mind-opening experience because I was like, oh, wait a minute. A guitar can do this as well as play Muddy Waters? And I was like, and then it branched out. You went to the Thornton School of Music at USC.
Yes.
How strict were they about the classical cello discipline? Because when I'm in New York City, I walk past Juilliard all the time, and on occasion you'll hear, you know, kids like practicing on, you know, and it's just to me, I envy them, and I almost feel sorry for them, because it's really it's black dots at a certain tempo, step repeat, criticize, and then
right.
Recite. How was that for you?
You know, like. So I just finished reading Outliers, you know, and it has a lot to do with this. But growing up, I was forced to practice, not by choice, forced, locked in my room 2 hours at a time, let out for 5 minutes to go to the bathroom, drink water, like that extreme of a training boot camp. So 8 hours a day from when I started. So by the time I got to college, that was already in my psyche. I'm sure that has a lot to do with why I'm like half robot, because I was just raised like that. Even in college, I think I practiced at the minimum 6 hours a day. So I still did that. For classical music, because it was just part of my identity. I'm like, this is all I know how to do. I don't even know how to ride a bicycle. Like, I literally didn't have any exposure to anything. It was food and cello. So I practiced a lot. And I have to say that I feel like out of all of my professors or teachers, there were maybe two that were very supportive when they recognized that there's something a bit off about this one, me. And my cello professor, she was this amazing older German lady. So when I started studying with her, she was already 85, but she was fabulous. She still wore heels. I mean, I can barely wear heels, and she's 85 carrying a cello, wearing a skirt and heels, a longer skirt, respectable length, right? And she was so wonderful, because I told her, you know, I want to experiment with like heavier types of music. And she didn't quite understand. She didn't know what anything else was. So she kept calling me playing metal jazz. And she always said, oh, dearie, show me some of your jazz music. And I'm like, it's not jazz. But she was very open about it, as long as I also did my classical stuff. So at that time, I did start touring a little bit with like never like A-level orchestras. I never got to that point, but you know, with the orchestras, I was leaving school for sometimes 2 or 3 weeks at a time, doing these tours, playing purely classical music, which is actually why I ended up dropping out, because I couldn't maintain, you know, both. So I was in school for 2.5 years doing classical music, but I did have a lot of teachers who really hated my guts, you know, because I remember there was one class, Baroque cello. I totally get that. Like, people have I think in classical music, they have very specific ideas, some people, of how things should be played. You have to play it this way. But to me, it's always been like, okay, that's great. First of all, there were no recording devices back in Bach's era. So how on earth do you know that it was supposed to be played like that? Right. But of course, you can't say that directly, or you'll get slapped across the face or kicked out of school.
A lot of violence has happened in the classical world. I never would have thought.
Okay, I might be dramatizing a little bit.
Bow, you know, they'll fall.
Actually, yeah, there was one violin professor at Colburn School, who shall not be named, who was known for having an extra violin and a bow that was made out of some kind of metal material, just so he could whack his students and not harm his own violin. So anyway, that's you know, talk for another day. No, but I remember I got a D in that class, because I didn't even play it that crazy. I just chose to do it my own way. I tend to be a little melodramatic in my style. I just can't help it. It comes out. Right. And so she hated the way that I played it, and she gave me a D. But you know, I really think everybody's different. You know, there are some musicians who go to classical music school who love that type of structure, and they you know, it works for them. For me, like something like playing in an orchestra, again, I love orchestral music, obviously, there's nothing wrong with it. But for me, like my parents, their dream was for me to join an orchestra and like be one of the cellists in the orchestra section, because that's like kind of like a safe office job for musicians, because you have a, you know, 401k and not to be.
You got dental. Oh, sorry. Go ahead. You get dental.
A dental, you know, and for me, I'm again, I don't mean to be melodramatic or whatever, but that is like suicide. You know, that's what's the point of your life if everything you do, you're being told what to do, told how to play. You're just like every, you know, you play. I get shivers just thinking about it. You know, so yeah, that was my school experience with music.
One of the things about you know, performers, mm-hmm. and there's guitar players and cellists and singers, and you know, and it's easy to fall into the rest of the group. And then there's the people that rise above it and become soloists, front people and you know, whatever. The common denominator to all that is there's that fire in the belly and the chip on the shoulder.
Yes.
And you see it in all types of performance. It's like who becomes character actors, very talented character, who becomes lead actors, who becomes second chair cello, who's a featured soloist. And there's always a difference in the delivery. It's the way that even if you mute the orchestra, if you mute mm-hmm. everything, it's you're capturing the visual and the emotion. And that kind of emotion and passion for what you do is contagious, and it becomes like, oh, I don't know what's going on over there, but I'm watching. I cannot take my eyes off of Tina Grove because she is ripping into this cello. It may not be within the rule book, but mm-hmm. it's entertaining, and it gets back down to that. When did you know in your life as a musician, when you were touring with some orchestras in college, when did you know you had that to where you could enthrall and encapsulate an audience just by pulling the cello out and ripping into it?
Well, first of all, thank you. That is extremely complimentary. that will carry me through the day and through all my Nespressos I'm going to drink after this. I have to say that playing classical music, even when I was, you know, doing some solo stuff, I never felt like I had become myself. During that time, still to this day, I get nervous playing classical music because I feel like the audience like might judge you, you know, if you play one wrong note or something that's not, you know, so I have that nervousness. But when I play, not necessarily electric cello, but just any music outside of the classical genre where you are free because you're doing whatever it is that you want or something you've written. I mean, nobody can tell you what to do if you wrote the piece, right? I think it took me quite a while. So I started experimenting with the electric cello and alternative styles of playing when I was 19. And I feel like it took me at least 3 solid years of daily, like trying to figure out what the fuck I'm doing to get to the point where I felt actually comfortable with the instrument. And I don't know, like I try to think about like where, you know, where was the turning point or how did things manifest? And I think one big turning point for me, that you can actually quantify, you know, that I can like show as an example, was when I released the Queen Bee music video. It's a heavy metal, you know, video. And actually it is Flight of the Bumblebee, but like a kind of a metal version. And at that point, I was at a low point. I was living in Sun Valley, which is like a little bit north in, you know, in LA, not a great area. I found this, it was a garage, half a garage. The landlord had his car parked in the other half because I couldn't afford anything else. It was like $400 a month, including utilities. That was a big one. And so I was.
Gasoline to wake up to, right?
It's what? Yeah,
it was like great. The smell of gasoline.
Yeah, like the wall separating me from the car was like a plastic partition. It was terrible. It was wonderfully terrible. And so, you know, I lived there and I was really struggling to try to make enough money to like pay off some of the, you know, I had a full scholarship for school, but it didn't cover living expenses, books, you know, my instruments, my God, which can be super expensive. So I was like struggling to try to pay everything and doing these little like one-off gigs for like, I remember like $50, I think, on the strip. I would play with anybody on Craigslist who needed a cello player, cello whore available. Right. So I was really struggling, and I was struggling for like a couple of years. I mean, this wasn't because I had left school because I was doing the classical stuff, but the classical stuff doesn't pay very much. And it also, I mean, it requires so many hours of practice. I remember I learned the Shostakovich cello concerto when I was living in that garage, and I practiced that for 10 hours a day because I never played it before, like for 6 months leading up to. So it was, yeah, it was a, you know, not to be like boo-hoo, woe is me, but it was a pretty shitty time. And my parents told me, they're like, you know, we told you you're throwing your whole life away. There's an opening in the San Diego Symphony for a section cellist, and the salary was like $45,000 a year, which to me at the time was an astronomical amount of money. I'm like, oh my God, like $45,000, like I can not have to buy food in the clearance aisle of Ralph's, you know, anymore. So, right. So I told myself, all right, like maybe I have to like deal with reality and just go in that direction, but I have to have my last hurrah because I don't feel like I've actually shown what it is that I'm like, that I'm imagining in my head. And I did actually, it's funny what you said about, you know, walking down the street and telling people you're a blues guitar player. I feel like some people would ask me like, what is it that you do? Or like what, and I'm like, oh, like I want to play, you know, metal cello. I kind of got this like, oh, that's cute. Or that's nice. Or okay, sure. But people don't understand because it's not real until you make it real. And I realized that was my issue. I never actually managed to find a way to fucking make it happen, to like give you like a video or something to demonstrate what it is that I wanted to do. So I thought, okay, if I'm going to like give up on my dreams, right, and go work in an orchestra, no offense, oh my God, to any orchestra players who might be watching this, orchestras are great. Just not for me. I said, okay, I saved like, I think it was like about $2,000 in my entire life savings, right? And I'm like, okay, I'm going to find a way to make a music video that is exactly what I want to do artistically. And maybe when I'm old and I can show my grandkids, be like, hey, look at grandma, when she was 20 something. And that was really all I intended for, because I don't want to say give it up because it sounds so dramatic, but it just wasn't, you know, I just couldn't see how I could have like a nice life and own a home or whatever, like living like that. So it took me about 6 months to get all the production stuff together because, you know, when you don't have money, you have to try to do everything. So many friends and like really like helped out and like were able to pull favors. We got the location for free. It was the coffin. Have you heard Coffin Case? The, you know, they make the coffin shaped guitar cases. Johnny was so kind that he's like, oh, you can shoot in our factory. I mean, there's a bunch of cases, but if you could just, you know, so it was shot in the factory for free. And anyway, I made this video, and in the back of my mind, I did think like, oh, like maybe if I put the video out on this new thing called YouTube, like maybe like Metallica or Rammstein or Marilyn Manson or like maybe, or Yngwie Malmsteen or whoever I was like watching after that, maybe somebody will see it and like they'll whisk me away on tour and then I can play like, you know, cello and I won't have to join the orchestra. Right, so that's what I was thinking. And I had done some recording stuff for like soundtrack music, which I'm heavily involved in now, but it wasn't really my focus because I just wanted to, you know, I wanted to tour and perform and play heavy music or whatever. So I put the video out. I remember I didn't have like money for rent or food the next month because I literally spent like everything that I had, right? And 1 week after the video came out, Hans Zimmer called me. John Debney, who's like also a very well-known composer, Jungle Books, like Passion of the Christ and some of these other big, big films. And when Hans called, like when his assistant called me, I didn't even know who he was because I just didn't even think about that of like, oh, I should work in soundtracks. And so somehow I just did a complete like, you know, over to this side. But the funny thing is, I feel like when you really focus passionately, like your energy on something, perhaps the things that manifest aren't quite exactly what you imagine, but it's still, you know, because I was able to play some very heavy in my metal style cello on these soundtracks. And now, you know, what, 11, almost 12 years later, like, for example, something like the Wonder Woman main theme that I did with Hans, like to me that, I mean, that's pretty heavy, that's metal. And I said, oh my God, like I'm grateful every single day because it, I mean, that video, I put everything into it. It was my last like, bye world. and it actually eventually like turned into a lot of different random things, you know?
I think every successful musician has a moment in their lives where they bet it all on themselves. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't bet on yourselves, how are you going to get somebody else to bet on you? And And we had our moment in 2009, same thing, just put the video out there. Didn't realize that PBS was going to pick it up. All of a sudden, you know, it goes boom. And you don't know why. You know, I never thought I would be the PBS blues guy. I'm not arguing with that. You know, I'm not, I'll take it. You know, and you know, you do a lot of stuff with the video game industry, the soundtrack industry.
Yeah.
Here's a little fun fact for the kids out there. And I learned this at Abbey Road when I was doing my record last year. And I learned it for some score, you know, folks and some orchestra guys, because there's a shared commissary in the basement. And they said, you know, Joe, the video game industry is larger than the TV, music, and film industry combined. I'm like, excuse me? Because, like, if you took it all, put together the video game industry, that's why you can't get an orchestra room now. That's why, because they're constantly scoring games. And the fact that you can pivot and but still follow your passion is a testament to and great advice to all young musicians who just want to go out there and play. It may not be what you envisioned to begin with, but you end up getting there anyway.
Yes, exactly. And yeah, video game music and all other soundtrack music for me also, it is exciting and fun because every soundtrack is completely different. Right. And like, I need a lot of, I get bored easily. So I like all of that different stimulation and learning different types of music. Yeah, it's amazing. And video games, I mean, that's a whole other thing. I mean, I did a whole cover of like video game covers. And something I do love about soundtrack music in general is that there are no boundaries. Like, I'm not into the whole, this genre of music or that. I mean, it's all just music. Right. So, and I love the fact that you can find everything, even types of music where you're like, what on earth is that? There is no genre for that, but it's all okay as long as it serves the picture. So I do like the fact that it's extremely open-minded, I think, as far as just, you know, types of music involved.
Well, yeah, and you're musically adventurous because, and I use no other point to make other than this one. I could imagine when Kevin Shirley called you up and said, hey, there's this blues guitar player doing an acoustic tour.
Right.
You want to play? You're like, what? No.
Yeah, I'm like,
no. You know, could you have ever imagined your career at that point in time that the same person responsible, you know, for a gig at Carnegie Hall is now responsible for inviting you on a show called Live from Nerdville? I mean, these are keep a career. There's one career high, one career low. You know, I mean, can you imagine that?
Like, oh man, it's just mind blowing. It's incredible.
is music the universal language?
I think there's other universal languages, but yes, music is one of the most powerful one.
Mm-hmm.
Food would be another one. I love to eat. Sorry, I just keep thinking about food.
See, this is a good pivot. You're very active as far as health and fitness, and somebody who like I've always struggled with weight and things and try to keep it down. And there's one of the things that throughout a pandemic that the discussion has never really pivoted to is health and fitness, because there's no pill that's going to substitute for bad choices in diet. And your dogs are named Pizza and Bagel.
Yes.
Which tells me that you like carbs.
So I love carbs.
Tell the folks like how do you maintain that balance? You know, with diet, but then also going, hey, listen, I'm a human being. I like Domino's, you know, or I like, send me a deep dish pizza once in a while. How do you maintain that balance? Because it's very valuable information for people.
You know, I'm it's something I'm working on, but I tend to be a bit of an extremist, you know, like I mentioned earlier, anything, anyone, any whatever I'm into, I take it to the extreme and I tell myself I shouldn't, but I can't help it. So right. For me, it's more of like extremes in moderation, which mm-hmm. is a complete, you know, dichotomy. So last year I started off the pandemic when everything stopped and I'm like, oh my God, and now I have all this time at home. I'm going to really get in shape. I'm going to work out. And I did it for a little bit, for like a few months. And then I went through some personal things, the relationship I was in completely obliterated, but it's okay. I'm happier now. So it's okay. So I went through that. I had a health situation back in December. So it was only a few months ago where I had some precancerous cells in my cervix. So I had surgery, I had that taken out, everything's okay now. And it was after that, because there was a moment or a day when I thought, oh my God, like, what if it does turn into cancer? What if I die? I'm 35 years old. I spent my entire life, and this has to do with what we were talking about with the touring. I'm like, I spent my entire life working, touring, obsessively focused on my career and building my net worth and trying to, like, I mean, I enjoyed it. It's not that I didn't enjoy it, but I'm like, but what about me? Who am I without, if I take all that stuff away, who am I as a person? You know? It's so, I don't know. I just had this whole thing, and I had also gained a lot of weight, you know, during that time, because I felt sorry for myself. And also I wasn't supposed to, like, be exercising for a while. So I was, I mean, you say the deep dish pizza. I always eat, when I eat Domino's, I eat at least one entire pan pizza. It's like medium, but it's pretty thick. It's like 3,000 calories. Sometimes I can eat two. I mean, it's a lot. And I have, like, a weird, like, you know the feeling when you get, like, so full that you can barely move?
Mm-hmm.
I like that feeling. And I know that's terrible. Like, it's not, you're not supposed to like it. But, like, when I get so, like, full, I'm like, oh, I feel terrible. I love this. You know? So
let's do it tomorrow.
Yes. So on January 1st, I told myself, all right, I'm going to let myself just be a disgusting pig until December 31st. Right. But then on 2021 is a new year. It's going to be the new year. I'm going to really, I want to reach self-actualization. I want to become the best version of myself I can possibly be. I'm 35. It's the new 25, whatever. Okay. So I started this Blogilates, which is she is an amazing Pilates instructor and fitness. It's not just Pilates, but it started with that, that I follow. And I followed her for years, but I never really followed her calendar, like, methodically. So mm-hmm. She had a 21-day challenge on, like, you know, who can make the biggest transformation in 21 days. So I thought, okay, I need, again, structure. I need someone to, like, give me an exact schedule.
Right.
So, you know, I followed it. I lost a good amount of weight, but I think it's not even about the weight. I think it's just feeling stronger. I was one of the winners of the contest. So that was really exciting. I got a free yoga mat and everything. So
listen, like, we're 21 days the mat alone. Come on.
Yeah. And then after that, I've just kind of continued. So I subscribed to her, you know, her app. It's a lot more intense, because back then it was only 21 minutes a day. That was the thing. Like, you only have to work out 21 minutes a day. Now it's like an hour a day. But I think, you know, just, I just tell myself I have to do it. It's not something you think about. It's like practice. I don't feel like practicing a lot of the times. So you just have to do it. Too bad, Tina. You have to work out. And I do feel great afterwards. And as far as the food, I am tracking all my calories with, like, my Fitness Pal. On occasion, like yesterday, I didn't track, but I only ate. Well, okay, no, I did eat pretty late. Never mind. Erase that. Okay, yesterday was a bad day. But today, you know, I track my calories. And I also try to do intermittent fasting, which is, like, you know, I will eat in an 8-hour period throughout the day. So 16-8. So yeah, and so far it seems to be working. I think just focusing for me on how good I feel when I do feel a little bit stronger. It's not about being skinny or whatever, but I want to be, you know, stronger without looking like the Hulk, because that's not attractive for a woman. So yeah, that's my thing. And then on occasion, I'll allow myself to binge, because I love to binge eat.
Right.
Which is, well, not good.
You know, that's, you know, I have a cheat day once a month, and it's fried. Fry it.
Once a month. That's intense. Whoa.
Microphone. Okay. Put it in a deep fryer. I'm in. Fry the utensils, the plates. I'm taking it all. One of the things about dieting is counting calories. It's those nutrition labels on the back of food are there for a reason. And there's sometimes, like, you know, people go, like, I don't understand, like, why I'm not losing weight. All I had today was, I had a Cobb salad and you know, a turkey sandwich. Like, well, you were better off with a burger and fries than the Cobb salad.
The Cobb salad is going to kill you. No.
And you're going, but I'm eating salads. It's the amount of calories in things. And I learned this by reading those books, Eat This, Not That, you know, the restaurant guides. And now it's all digital, and you can put it in your phone, where you just, you know, like, I had a chicken breast and some asparagus. Okay, well, there's $600, you know, 600 calories. But it's a lifestyle commitment, you know, and it's balance, because, you know, there's some people that are just not, they want to get a quick diet, 30 days, 30 pounds in 30 days. Like the ones that do, like, and I'm not putting them down, like the Atkins and keto. I know some people have done the keto diet, and they literally put butter in their coffee. I said, that is not sustainable for the rest of your life. Do you see yourself at 65 putting butter in your coffee and having a 40-ounce tomahawk steak, you know, to maintain your weight? You're going to kill yourself in a different way if you don't do it. It's just about balance of your caloric intake and the foods that you do eat. You know, it's tough. Not a lot of people are naturally skinny. I'm jealous of them.
Yeah, definitely. No, I mean, just like you said, something that's maintainable, because every fad diet you can think of, including what you just talked about with the butter and the giant steaks, I've tried them all. It's not, I loved it. It tasted great, but it's not sustainable. Plus, I don't think it's really healthy, you know, to be eating so much red meat, which I also like. But now, like, I don't restrict anything from my diet. I eat everything, but just in a smaller amount. And then if you control the hours from, like, I mean, it's not even that bad. Like, if you eat between what, 12 and 8, like, that's still most of the day, you know? So, so far it's been good. And I'm actually very, very motivated to continue that and to keep that going. Cause I do feel better, you know, mentally, spiritually, physically. So it's good.
All right. Here comes the geek questions.
Okay.
Before we wrap up here, Tell me about the Tina Guo model signature Yamaha. Is that one of them behind you?
Oh, no, actually, that is not a signature cello, Yamaha. You should be making a signature cello for me. No, I'm kidding.
Cello?
I do. Well, I actually have my own line of instruments. So that's, it's under Tina Guo Strings. So we have the models 300 and the 600. They're acoustic cellos and bows in carbon fiber and wood in a variety of rainbow colored horsehair. So you can actually dye the horsehair and it's available for all string instruments. So I have that, pickups, all kinds of random stuff. For my electric cello, I do play on a Yamaha electric cello, but this is pretty much their standard cello, just painted pearl white. And I have, I think this is my fourth one. I kind of tend to break cellos a lot when I'm touring, a little too aggressive. They're like, can you just play like with less aggression? I'm like, no, I can't.
Right.
I'm like, destroying.
Are you breaking the necks off or how?
Apparently I'm like hitting, I think I'm hitting it too hard when I play. And then it's like breaking the internal components, like all the little computer. I mean, you know. It happens.
Make them tough for touring, you know? I tell people, like, you know, if somebody brings me an amp that they built, the boutique or whatever, and then I always turn it up almost all the way.
Right.
Well, that's a little extreme. I go, well, then don't put 10 on the amp if I can't turn it up to 10.
Exactly. Yeah. I think, one other time, for people who don't know, the electric cello, I play standing, and there's a long end pin. It's like a metal end pin with a very sharp tip. I mean, you technically could kill somebody with it. So sometimes, you know, I'm like walking around on stage and I go, I was feeling extremely viscerally, aggressive that night. Right. So I just went, oh, like so hard that the end pin impaled the cello itself, basically, and it just, like, I think it damaged the, so that was another, I don't know, just, you know, impaling itself, hitting it too hard, but it's, I don't want to blame, it's not the quality of the instrument, I think I just might be a little out of control, so it's my fault.
Listen, you know, I think it's great, you know, some battle scars. How important, you know, you're one of the greatest musicians I know, a friend, and also an entrepreneur, and just as we wrap up, tell anybody, a 20-year-old Tina Guo, what you've learned about being a businesswoman in the last 15 years since, you know, since you started basically your own brand.
Yes, I would say take the time to invest in yourself through education. I think knowledge is like the most important thing, because you spent so many years, your entire life training on, you know, in music on your instrument. But if you can't, because again, the music business, there's the word business in it. So it's one thing to be a musician for fun in your basement or whatever, which is great, you know, great. But if you actually want to make a living out of it and turn it into a viable career, hopefully a fiscally, you know, lovely one, then you have to understand some of these things. And sometimes I talk to people because I used to do these like consultation sessions for musicians and other creatives. And some of them say, oh, I just don't understand it. I said, listen, if you can figure out how to read like music notes and learn how to like literally saw wood with like metal on it, you can understand basic business concepts, you know? So just to take the time, you know, read the books, read articles, everything's free now, you know, on YouTube, you just watch these. And I learn by trial and error, I was fucked over many times, you know, which, but it's good because they were all learning experiences. And then just to practice it, because you'll never become comfortable negotiating your own deals or talking to people directly in a nice, but, you know, firm way about things if you don't practice it. So if it feels terrible and embarrassing, like you still have to get through the initial awkward phase of, you know, every type of relationship or growth to get to the comfortable place.
Have you ever used an assumed name to represent yourself?
I thought about that, but no, I even thought I was like practicing like different voices, like, oh, like what kind of voice? I'm terrible with like other voices. So no, I mean, I think some people think it's like odd or surprising. Like even when I signed to Sony, to my label, they're like, you know, who do we talk? I'm like, no, I'm just me. It's just me. They're like, you don't have anyone representing you. And I've tried it with a few different managers, nothing against them. Maybe I just haven't met the right match yet, you know, the right person or whatnot. But so far, I think also it's because what I do is so weird or just random. And it's not like there's so many other, I don't know, you know what I'm trying to say? It's like difficult to really see eye to eye on things.
And you have your things so tight and focused that you don't need somebody riding up on a white horse taking a percentage of your sweat equity over the last 15, 20 years. You know what I mean? It's like, what can you bring to the table other than taking a phone call on my behalf, which I'm happy to take and discuss intelligently, you know? It's a tough match because, you know, it's somebody who comes in to manage you in theory has to be able to move the needle in a way that you can't on your own. And
exactly.
It's like, they're going to call the same people, you know, they're going to your Rolodex. Is that still a thing? I'm old. Your phone. They're going to raid your phone and then steal your contacts. I've seen it happen a million times, you know, and but you know, I mean, you know, I have the utmost respect for you and selfishly, I miss you. I haven't seen you in a while and we've just, you know,
5 years.
5 years. But thank you very much. You're an inspiration to a lot of young people and a lot of people outside of your world. Because, you know, it's a very, really cool thing you've created in your own world. And lucky are the few that are focused enough, dedicated enough, and are able to do it and pull it off. So my hat, in theory.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Tina Guo from Las Vegas, Nevada.
Bye.
Thank you for watching. Until next time, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Joe Bonamassa right here on Live from Nerdville.